topic in this series on resurrection. I hope you've enjoyed it so far. I certainly have, although I've missed two. But did you know you can catch up on the web? Just go to St. John's website and they will be there. It's my pleasure this afternoon to introduce Andrew, whom I've known for many, many years. And he's going to talk on what it is to experience resurrection. So not so much the event, but how we take it on board in our own lives and in our own faith. So, over to you, Andrew.
About resurrection has been something which has been going through my mind for many years. And just if you think about resurrection, you think, oh yes, I know what the story is. It's not on, is it? Should be on. It's on? Should be on. Okay. Move it across. Is that better? Can you hear? Turn it down. Okay? That way. Clockwise. Yeah? Can you hear now? Hello. Is that all right? All right. I'll speak loudly. Okay. Looking at the resurrection has been something which has been a concern for me for many years, and I've looked at it and thought, yes, I know what the stories are, but then you look at them again and you realise you don't quite know what the stories are, and actually got them confused in your mind. So what I did a little while back was look again at the stories of what happened after Jesus' death. So, let's reboot. There are four key stories within the church's year. And within those four stories, we have got a description of what happened for Christmas, Good Friday, and Pentecost. Now, you might not believe those stories, but they are the stories that we have for those great events. But if you look at the story of the resurrection, you find there's a gap. We know what happened up to Jesus' death. We know about his being put in the tomb. We have some stories about what happened sometime after he was raised. But we have nothing about what actually happened at the resurrection. Now, that's quite a strange thing. Now, if you don't believe me, what I've tried to do with your handout is to look at the stories just up to the resurrection. So the first page of your handout gives you the four Gospels and their account of what happened post the death of Jesus and what happened up to the point of the Saturday. Jesus died on the cross. They all agree. He was taken down from the cross by Joseph of Arimathea. Now, I won't get into how that happens, but believe you me, most of the paintings of the descent from the cross, I don't think are right, because if you think about the way the cross is constructed, you would never take a body down as they're depicted in paintings. But we know that he was taken down from the cross, and we also know that he was wrapped in a cloth. That's quite normal. And then he was laid in an unused tomb cut out of the rock. And this action was witnessed by some women, and then once Jesus was, his body was put in the tomb, a huge stone was rolled over the entrance. And that's where this exhibition starts off, with that display of Jesus in the tomb. That's what we think we know happened to Jesus' body. And then on the Sabbath, the Saturday, the site of the burial was left alone. That's what we've got. That's all we've got. What happened next? If you look at the next stage, the next page of your handout, you have got the stories in the Gospels immediately after the people first arrived at the tomb. What happened? Some women came to the tomb. Number? It varies between the accounts. They found that the stone had been moved. They found that there was no body in the tomb. Sorry, no body in the tomb. Because if you look at Mark, there was a young man in there. Not Jesus, but there's a young man. And another common feature is they ran away from the tomb in a state of fear. So this is where this really is the starting point of what we have in this exhibition. And we have to say, okay, fine. How can we represent this stage of the resurrection? And over in this corner, we've got this, the first part of the story, the empty tomb. Now, I found it very interesting that Nick found this very difficult to paint. Because the trouble is, there is a total ambiguity about how you should paint it. In my mind's eye, the tomb is dark. There is nothing there. It's empty. And looking into the tomb, it's doubly dark. Because the light is behind you, and you're looking into a hole where there is no light. So whatever light there is that could get into the tomb, you are in the way. So we're doubly dark. But there's another alternative, and that's what Nick has painted in his painting. That looking into the hole, looking into the emptiness, there is some light that's coming out of the tomb. And this is what I think Mark wants us to consider. He wants us to go to the empty tomb and to be confronted by the nothingness that is there. And he wants us to say, look, folks, what are you staring at? What are you hoping for? Because it's not here. If you want to hold on to anything, it's not here. My purpose cannot be grasped if you want to look into the empty tomb. And this is a transition point. It's really saying, are you going to be a person of faith, or do you need to be a person where you're clinging on to substance? Now, this picture actually gives you a clue about how we find the resurrection, how we find God in our lives. The very fact that I would see it in dark, Nick sees it in light, shows one thing. The picture is ambiguous. And that's one of the ways in which God talks to us, through ambiguity. We go up to a point in life, we think we know what we're going to expect, and we find that it's different. And that's how God asks us, are you ready? Now we come on to the next painting in the exhibition. And that part, to me, speaks of what is actually happening between Nick and myself about the image of the empty tomb. It talks about the light and the dark in equal measures. This is for me. It talks for me of light and dark in equal measures. And the gold and the yellow talk to me about God's presence. So where do we find God's presence? We find it in the dark, where there's the greatest amount of gold, and in the light, but it's not quite so distinct in the light. We see it as yellow. And between the two, it's linked by God's presence. So the channel of understanding the light and the dark is God. We find God in the light and the dark. And there's some black lines. Well, please note, those are saying notes to me. The music of heaven. God is to be found both in the light and the dark, and he is connecting between them. So, we then go on to the picture of what happened at the tomb. And there's some consistency between the Gospels about this. Angels in the tomb. A young man in Mark. I think the angels are in Matthew. And I don't know whether in Luke. I can't honestly remember if there are no. But the point about this is that, as Nick said in his talk, the angels are welcoming, but the women are fearful. The angels have a message to share. They are saying where the risen Jesus is to be found. And in two of the Gospels, it says, go to Galilee. And two of the Gospels, it's ambiguous about whether it's, well, in Luke, it's definitely Jerusalem. And in John, it's Galilee and Jerusalem. So we have a message for the women. We have an indication of how Jesus is to be found. And we have a statement of fear. Why fear? When you are confronted with a situation which doesn't seem to be the way it should be, you are unnerved. So fear is quite an expected thing to find in an encounter with God, because what you are experiencing is something beyond your current experience. So to be fearful in the presence of God seems to me a natural reaction. You know that you're loved by God, and the more that you know that you're loved by God, the more you can counter that fear. But if you are apprehensive about life, if you trust your own judgment, if you trust your own being, then it's likely that you'll be confronted by a state of fear. And this is another clue about discovering the nature of divine in our ordinary life. That when God's revelation comes to us, he is bringing us to a greater state of being which is beyond our grasp, or has been beyond our grasp. And this disturbs our view of life. And it's quite natural that this gives rise to a time of disquiet. Now, this leads me on to Robert Wright's painting of the burning presence of God's mystery, God in mystery. And what that painting reminded me of was a picture which was turned into a cushion of Klimt's. And this picture reminds me of the process that material goes through in this earth when it goes into a trench and is reconfigured into granite. We have the structure, we have a state of amazing heat which melts the rock and it then reforms, and it forms into different ways, and some of the good bits are formed into great big bits. And somebody pointed out today, this is a bit like how diamonds are formed deep in the Earth's crust. You can see this process of the loss of one set of structure, the heat, and then the melting, and then the reformation. That strikes me about the way God works with us. Again, it's like we are in one state or form. We encounter the divine, which is a bit of a burning presence, and then we reform in a better way, and a way in which we can have a greater appreciation of the divine in our life. And that's what I see again in Robert's painting. It's the melting pot. The impurities, the blackness, is displaced and new structures are brought into being. Those new structures at the first are fragmentary, but then with time they begin to coalesce and form a new structure. So when we encounter the divine, what happens? Old structures disappear, new ones start to re-emerge. But don't fool yourself that when this has happened once, it's not going to happen again. It goes on and on and on throughout your life. Newman had a saying, to live is to change. To change often is to become perfect. I believe God breaks in order to recreate. And that's the constant cycle of growth in terms of the spiritual life. So, when you experience the resurrection, let's have a look at the personal experiences that go on, or we've got witness to, in the Gospels. Mark has nothing. There is nothing there in Mark about what happens when you encounter Jesus. The women run away in fear. The end of the gospel, beyond verse 8, there's nothing there. It's an add-on from people looking back and saying, this is unsatisfactory. But Mark wants us to be in that state. We'll come back to why, but so let's look at the other gospels. In Matthew, there is one fleeting appearance. As the women flee away from the tomb, he meets them, says, hi, go to Galilee. And then the next scene that we have is Jesus meeting the disciples in Galilee and commissioning them on their life's work. But post-resurrection, there is no personal encounter apart from a very brief, fleeting encounter in Matthew. Luke goes one stage further, and there is this beautiful story that Hugh Wybrew talked about the journey to Emmaus, which we have over there. If you came to Hugh's talk, it was beautiful. The gentle encounter with God. How does he do it? He walks alongside. He encourages us to talk about our experiences, especially the painful things. the things that we don't understand. And then he reveals himself through an action that is familiar. He doesn't say, "Oh, look at me, I'm here." He waits for us to recognize him in the action. Bishop Stephen, who's now Bishop of Chelmsford, said a very interesting thing about this journey, the spiritual journey. He said, look at this story. How does Jesus get the disciples to experience the resurrection? What does he do? Does he say, this is the way it happened? No. He gets the people to express how life is for them and then ask questions. The first stage of transformation is listening to the other. Interesting. So then we go on into the upper room in Luke, and we have the upper room, and beyond the upper room we have the gift of the Holy Spirit is promised, and this is where the boundary line between Luke and Acts becomes blurred, because you know, when does the Holy Spirit really come? This is slightly strange, but what we have is not a personal encounter, other than, again, a fleeting reference to, oh yes, he appeared to Peter. So we don't know what went on. We can't describe it. All we can know is there were encounters. Mary Magdalene, where did she come in? Well, we then have to go to John. Now, John has three personal encounters. Mary Magdalene, first of the two, which is one of the ones that we have a bit further, which we'll talk about in a moment. We have also the disciples in the upper room, and Thomas, and then Thomas in the upper room, and then Peter. Look at the differences. We've got Jerusalem in both Luke and John, and then John takes them on to Galilee, where they're back in their ordinary life. So, let's return to Mark. Is it an unsatisfactory ending? It gives us no conclusion to hold on to. It doesn't explain a mystery. Why are there any communities of faith? If that's the ending, what are we all about? What were the first communities of faith all about? And why go to Galilee? What's he trying to say there? If we say that the whole of the purpose of Mark is in that ending, then do we have a resurrection? Are we, as Paul said, you know, more to be pitied than any others? Because, you know, if the resurrection doesn't exist, you know, what is there to Christianity? And by the way, if you think I've forgotten about the 500, it comes in 1 Corinthians 15. It doesn't come in the Gospels. Let's have a look at Matthew's edition. It's similar to Mark, but it's got this edition. Again, it's go to Galilee. It deals with a story about why there might be a missing body. That's Matthew's major edition. It talks about the soldiers being bribed to say that somebody stole the body. But then the commission that the disciples are given in Galilee, he gives them all authority to do what? To go to all, not just some, all nations, to baptize them, to teach and observe Jesus' commandments. And he's with you always. That, to me, is a huge comfort. Whatever situation we're in, Jesus is with us. Never alone. Never alone. All we have to do, all we have to find, is the way in which we honour Jesus' teaching. So, Luke and John's witness. There are personal encounters. And both of them deal with the process of acceptance. They're all also worried about saying whether Jesus is a ghost or not. And if you may remember in Luke's Gospel, Jesus eats some fish. We might wonder what type of fish it was. I think that's missing the point. The point is that he is physical enough that he can interact with the physical environment in ways that we know. And also, when we look at the stories in Luke and John, what do we find? We find, look at my hands. Not immediately, not in Luke anyway, look at my hands. And it's with Thomas in John. But there's the proof that there's a continuity between this world and the next, because the prints of the nails are seen to be in Jesus' hands. But what John does is he points out that different people are going to experience the resurrection in different ways. So, go back to the journey to Emmaus. The risen Jesus is with us. He deepens our understanding by confronting the issues which disturb us. And in that process, conversation and exploration is necessary part of it. The disciples don't come to an awareness straight away. It's a gradual process. And it's only in an action, that the penny actually drops. But when it does drop, you cannot stop yourself from trying to communicate that truth to others. So what's this tell us about what we need to know if we're going to experience the resurrection for ourselves? I believe it tells us that we don't get the experience of the resurrection by it being given to us. We have to engage with it. And if we're going to engage with it, it means that we're going to have to engage with those things that disturb us. That is the point of growth. So, God is requiring us to give of ourselves to the process of experiencing his presence more. We're showing by that we want to know more. We want to be in closer communion with him. Now, let's turn to John, because I find John's Gospel really very interesting. The fact that there are three resurrection stories. When I came to Oxford, I was very interested in the Enneagram. And I was fascinated by it, but I met up with someone who said, oh no, the Enneagram's a load of old tosh, don't believe any of that. But while I've been here, more and more people seem to understand that the Enneagram has got something to offer. And the Enneagram is built around an understanding of our character, which is based on primary fears. And the thing about the primary fear is if we are ever going to deny something quite vehemently, it is that we're afraid of our primary fear. So, it's what we resist the most. And in those there are nine types of primary fear that are recognised within the Enneagram, and they can be grouped into three major broad categories: head type, heart type, and gut type. So we have head-centered for the emotional people, heart-centered for the emotional people, head-centered for the rational people, and gut-centered for those who are impetuous. Mary Magdalene, for me, is the person who represents the emotional side. Thomas, the rational side, and Peter, the impetuous side. So how do they respond to the resurrection? Let's have a look at the story over there, Eularia Clark. Eularia Clark, I think, is doing a great service in this to us in this painting. She is quite clear that Mary is crying. That is clear from the story. Now, ask yourself, when you are crying, can you see things clearly? Answer, no. Well, if you're like me, I know that when I cry, my vision gets blurred. I'd also like to point out to you that it is a quality of being a human being that if you have your eyes shut, you cannot tell whether sound is coming from directly in front of you or directly behind you. That's something you might want to hold in your mind as you review this story in the future. What Eularia Clark has done is she's put Mary clinging on to the branch. Branch? Jesse, do I have to say anything more? But she's clinging on to the physical. And she is blinded by the light. She cannot see with her eyes. So when you can't see with your eyes, what do you see with? How can you communicate? I believe that these stories talk to us about how we communicate between this world and the next, through love. The people who were drawn into these resurrection experiences in this state are people who had a deep love for Jesus. And what does Jesus say to her? Woman, who are you seeking? Strange, isn't it? That was the same words that she heard from within the tomb. And then she turned around and heard them again. She turned around and she heard them again. She was looking into the tomb. Now she's looking out of the tomb. We've got this dark light parallel again. And what does Jesus say to Mary? Mary. Doesn't say, I'm risen from the dead. You might recognize me. Look at my hands. It's me. Just says, Mary. The relationship. The relationship. Just through knowing a person's name. Palestinians know that a name means the essence of the being. Jesus communicated with Mary, knowing her very essence, and she responded by knowing the name of her beloved. Is it?
Aramaic.
Oh, strange. So, a new spring, the daffodils are there. A new spring comes into life in Eularia's picture. And she's told not to cling on, not to cling on, but that's what her natural inclination is to do. That tells you about the nature of the character of people who are emotionally centered people. They try to cling on to the physical. They try to cling on to the definite. But Jesus is saying, don't cling on. And this is one of the major things that I think that John has to share with us, is if we want to experience the resurrection for ourselves, then we have to embark on non-possessive love. Let go. Allow to be. Don't throttle. Don't cling on. Then we move on to Thomas. Thomas is, for me, in the Enneagram at type 6, he is incredibly rational and amazingly trustworthy. He will go with you to the death. And isn't it interesting that when Jesus turned to go to Jerusalem, it was Thomas who said, "Let us go with him," even though he knew he might die with him. Thomas thinks he needs proof. I need to put my finger into the mark of the nails. I need to put my hand into his side. I will not believe. What's he saying by that? I only believe in those things which I can rationally prove to myself. He's extremely questioning. But the very fact that he stays with the disciples indicates something which is very interesting to me. That although he's still questioning, he's not rejecting. He's still open to something new being revealed to him. And so when he's confronted by the risen Jesus, what's he need? Oh, sorry, don't need anything. I now know the reality. And that is the transition that we need to make in life. A transition from knowing that everything from our basis to knowing the basis of the greater being and realizing that we are only here by the grace of God. Our life depends nothing upon ourselves. We are totally, absolutely, 100% dependent on God's love. And we live by faith. We think, oh no, we don't, no, faith is a strange thing. No, I would have it that even you drinking a glass of water is an act of faith. Because you don't know whether there's anything in there that you shouldn't be drinking. You haven't tested it, you've just got it out of the tap. So faith is what Thomas is challenged about, and he is encouraged to see that if you're going to enter into a deeper understanding of the resurrection life, faith is the essential quality. To recognize that we live by faith. We don't live by our knowledge and our full understanding. We live essentially by faith. Then we go back to Peter. Dear old Peter. I love this story. Peter. He is dissatisfied with life after Jesus' death. He's gone back to fishing. And it doesn't work for him anymore. And in this picture, notice the sea is choppy. Life isn't really hanging there together. It's not flat calm. It's not easy. And that's how life for Peter is without Jesus. Now, how would you feel if you've betrayed someone? Someone that you love. Oh, I'm desperately happy. Would you feel a deep sense of shame within? That your aspirations were actually vacuous. What Jesus does by the lakeside for me is he confronts Peter with his reality. And this is one of the things that dear Bubba pointed out to me. Jesus says, do you agape me? And Peter replies, I agape you. No, he doesn't. He says, I philios you. Now, that's a big turnaround for Peter, because Peter has always been the person who said, oh yes, you're the boss, you're the one we've all been looking for. He's prepared to be extravagant. But now, he's being realistic. So Jesus asks him again, do you agape me? Wouldn't it be lovely to say, yes, but he can't. He knows he's betrayed him. So he says, I philios you. This is the point at which Peter is, for me, going into that moment of total awareness that he's got to be real to himself. And Jesus says, finally, do you philios me? And Peter says, I philios you. The expression within the gospel, which I feel we've lost so much, is that the whole gospel is written in a culture of humility. And Peter is being encouraged by Jesus to recognize his true being with humility, accepting his limitations. And it is as we accept our limitations that we then can meet God. We can own our true being. There's a little saying that I say to people from time to time, which I like, you may not. You can't make a nest out of straight sticks. Think about it. You can't. Falls apart. We are all bent sticks. We try to portray ourselves as nice, clean, straight sticks. But if we're like that, we can never really form a community. Peter had to come to terms with his reality in order that the community of faith could be formed. So, one of the clues I think that comes from Peter is that we need to be totally honest about ourselves and our limitations, our strengths, our weaknesses, our true being. Now, I'm going to hop across to my favourite picture of this series, and it's the healing of blind Bartimaeus. Now, some of you might think, why has he got healing of blind Bartimaeus? It's not a resurrection story, is it? I think that Mark hid the resurrection story. And I think he hid it in the story of blind Bartimaeus. And the reason why I think that is because I think it's a Palestinian tale. Every name is significant. Where did the healing blind Bartimaeus happen? See, we're not Palestinians, we don't know. Jericho. Why Jericho? Because that was the place where the Israelites entered the Promised Land. Okay. So, his name. Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus. Why say it twice? Because there's an ambiguity about the meaning of the name. Son of the blessed, Son of the cursed. So we're standing at a transition point. What's the curse? What's the curse? Where's the curse in the Old Testament? Isn't it when Adam and Eve are chucked out of the garden and they cease that close relationship with God? So we're standing at the beginning of a new kingdom where the curse could be healed. Oh, why do I say curse? What does blind Bartimaeus call out? Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Why? Why doesn't he just say Jesus, Son of David, Son of David? He's blind. When the Israelites took Jerusalem from the Jebusite king said, even if you enter into this city, the blind and the lame will kill you. And from that day, the blind and the lame were cursed by David. Interesting. So we have blind Bartimaeus. We have him encountering Jesus. Now, we haven't got anyone who's blind here. So we don't know what it's like to be blind. But if you watch a blind person, they're very careful about where they put things, because they've got to remember where it is, otherwise they won't find it again. Blind Bartimaeus is sitting there and he hears this commotion and he says, who is it that's passing? Jesus. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Shut up. No. Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Bring him to me. And he throws off his cloak. He can't find it again. He's lost it. He comes up to Jesus and he says, Jesus says, what do you want me to do for you? He said, I want my sight back. He's telling Jesus his reality. Bartimaeus has fought the crowd to come through. And Jesus says, it's your faith that's healed you. And what does Bartimaeus do when his eyes are healed? He follows Jesus on the way. What's the way? It's the name that was given to the early Christians, followers. So, I think that what Bartimaeus has done is actually what John picked apart in his resurrection stories. Non-possessive, faith, be true to yourself. So, experiencing the resurrection is not to be found in places other than in Galilee. It's an ordinary place. It's in daily life. It's when we see things differently because we have non-possessive love, a true faith, and we are being true to ourselves. Which brings me on to the final picture in this exhibition by Robert Wright, an interpretation which I know is linked to spiritual direction. It's my interpretation. It may be totally different for you, but this is what it means for me. The gold is God. The red is our individual character. Notice the red is sitting very much in the gold. The orange is our experience that we can own of God, that we know of God. It isn't gold, it's close to gold, but it's not all of us. It's part of us. And that part of us, there is a blurry line between our own being and that of God. The blue circle sits ill at ease between red and orange. It's those difficult things in our life where we're not very sure about what God's doing, but they're there. We know they're there, the difficulties. But for me, that blue blob indicates the point of growth of our own understanding of God's presence in our life. Behind us is the dark blackness, the bit that we want to deny about ourselves. We will only become fully at one with God when we can own that, once we allow God's presence to be all enveloping. But the truth is that although we may have an understanding of God to some degree, there are bits which are beyond our understanding, and I believe that is the light blue in Robert's picture. Now, you may say, I don't get that. All I've given you is what I see there. And I think that the final clue that I want to give you is that the growth in our experience of the divine, and hence that link with the life beyond, comes from engaging with our difficulties. Now, I know I've taken you on a very long journey, and I've only left myself 4 minutes for questions, but I hope that's given you something. There is something.